Welcome to 1,000 Women, 1,000 Ways. And our amazing guest today is Casey. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
You're very, very welcome. Now you have a very interesting story that started with an earthquake.
It did. My husband and my children and I were all from Christchurch, New Zealand. And we were in the earthquakes back in 2011. And I was pregnant with my son. And my husband made the decision, just a lot of things that evolved, and my daughter, you know, obviously she was only six, and it was a very traumatic occasion, and he made the decision to move us all here to WA, to Perth, and my story began, my journey began, our fresh lives began. It's been amazing.
And do you think all the new beginnings, which we're going to talk about, that happened once you got to Perth, would have happened if you'd have stayed in New Zealand?
I can hand on my heart say no.
So sometimes when we there was a tragedy, obviously, that was not a great thing on the outside, but you've gone into it and found the gift.
Yeah.
Which is amazing. So what did you do when you get to Perth?
Obviously, had my son. I got over here and I had a beautiful little boy. And it was almost like, how do I put it? Back in Christchurch, you know, I'd lived there my whole entire life, had not left, and my husband and I had just become compliant with how life was, which I'm sure a lot of people do, and it sort of gets very monotonous and like Groundhog Day almost. And coming over here, excuse the pun, to do with the earthquake, but it was really the shake-up we needed.
Love it.
To evaluate our lives and give it a complete fresh start and make something of ourselves that we never thought possible. And obviously, you know, I had my son and just continued as normal. And you know, I'm one of those people where I've done every diet you can think of. There is not a diet, I think, that's probably yet to be written that I haven't tried. I have everything from pills to lotions to potions to voodoo magic to, you know, the only thing I've never done is gone under the knife. And, you know, I'd lose 5 kilos here. I'd think, yay, I'd stop. I'd gain 15. I do not know the mental trigger. I was obviously in the right frame of mind at the right time of my life. And there was an app that my neighbour actually had on her phone, and it was called 5K Runner. And I'd seen her sort of go out and do it, and I'm like, what are you doing? You know, you're running, you're walking, what are you doing? And she told me about this app, and I don't know what I was thinking, but I was like, if you can do this, I'm pretty sure I could give this a go. And it was all just perfect timing. I downloaded this app called 5K Runner, and whoever made that app has pretty much saved my life. I ran around the little oval in our local, when we were in Belia, running around the oval. I was 159 kilos when I started. And my husband was encouraging me the best he absolutely could, so he was right alongside me pushing the pram. And the very first day, it was you had to walk for a minute and a half, you had to run for 30 seconds, walk for a minute and a half, you repeat that 6 times. And I did it, got home, I laid on the dining room floor and thought I was gonna die. I couldn't believe. I was like, oh, there is no way I'm gonna run 8Ks. 5Ks, because it tells you you're going to run 5Ks in 8 weeks on this app. And I was like, whatever. Sure I am.
Yeah, I'm lying on the floor. I'm not going
anywhere. I'm laying on the floor and I'm just dying after doing 30 seconds of running. And it's great. It tells you, you know, it says come back in 2 days. And in 2 days' time, my phone went ding, ding. Time to run. And I'm like, okay. And it just crept up on you. I keep going every day, my husband with the pram. Keep going, keep going, keep going, and before you know it, I had done my first full run lap of the oval, you know, instead of running, walking, running, walking, running, walking. And people were there with their dogs, and you know, you get used to seeing the community. And I had people clap at me. I had people high five me. I had people I don't even know, you know, stop my husband and be like, she's doing so well. You know, I'd be purple. I would be purple in the face, and I couldn't breathe. And, you know, and they would just applaud me as I went past. And it was, it's kind of like stuff you see in movies and you go, what? I just kept doing it and kept doing it and kept doing it. And I graduated the program, the 8 weeks. I ran 5Ks, and I tell people I kind of, you know, channeled my inner Forrest Gump, you know, if I was going anywhere, I was running. Because I just haven't stopped. I just run.
How long ago was that now?
I started on the 27th of September 2012. So it's almost 3 years.
3 years. So it's like the app is like a kind of personal trainer saying, come on, get up. And then you have the support of your husband saying, let's do this.
Yeah.
And then the community joined in as well.
Yeah.
That's wonderful. And what kept you motivated? You had the support, but what was it inside of you?
I don't know.
Apart from Forrest Gump.
I think it was seeing my daughter, and all the time, no matter how big I was, my daughter, you would never ever catch her say, my mum's fat, you know. And even now, when I talk about when I was fat to now, she will still get upset, you were never fat. And she was so proud of me. You know, she would look at me and, I don't want to get emotional here, but
it's okay, feel free.
She was just so, I would go for a run and I'd get back and she would open the, she'd see me coming up the driveway, and you know, that last little end bit, you try and blast out everything you've got in you, and we had an incline of a driveway, so, you know, I'd you know, I couldn't breathe, and I couldn't breathe, let alone knock on the door or try and open it, you know, I'm just like, huh? And she'd open the door, and there'd be a glass of water ready, and it's like, well done, Mum, you did really well, you know, and it was like, I did, didn't I, you know? And then there's my husband, who, I still have moments where I look at him and go, what were you thinking, like, how did you love me then? You know? And he's like, because you were you, I love you no matter what. And you know, I sometimes think, oh, you got rocks in your head. But the support from him has just been amazing. And every kilo, every, you know, I used to run to, well, originally I would drive to weigh myself in at the doctor's every week religiously. And then one day I was like, it's only about 5.5K round trip. I'm going to try and run. So I ran. And then I got all the doctors on side, you know, and all the receptionists. And I was there for my weekly weigh-in. And they were all like, you know, waiting for today's numbers. And then, you know, I broke that barrier of double figures, you know. And I had, there were three receptions at the Thompson's Lake Medical Centre ladies, and because they saw, you know, have you broken the 100 yet? And I'm like, no, I only did 300 grams this week, or I only did 600 grams this week, and I'm 101, you know, and then that day I came out, and I was shaking, and they went, and I went, I did it 99.8, you know, and they were almost going to cry, because they'd see me every week, every single week, on the same day, every Saturday morning, I was there, weighing myself. Some days I would leave going, and some days I'd leave like, oh my God, I lost like 2 kilos this week, how did that happen? Because I ate chocolate, you know? Just support from people you just do not know, because everyone can relate. Everyone somehow related to, I kind of I don't know how I managed to do it, but everyone became invested in this, and we were all losing weight together.
You know? So you were inspiring other people. So your daughter, it sounds like she was your cheerleader. Rah, rah, yay, mom, and your husband's ever so supportive. And then you started to pay it forward because you started to inspire other people, and they were getting great joy from watching you achieve.
Yeah. And it was this year that I was like, right, because I, in the back of my head, because I'd done all those things in the past, the back of my head I was, you know, you kind of have that, I'm going to fail somewhere along the line. I have every other time, every pill I've tried, potion I've tried, lotion I've tried, I've failed. So you've kind of got that built in. And as much as, you know, it's the whole Jekyll and Hyde thing, I don't want to fail, I'm not going to fail. Yeah, don't get too many, you know, don't, it was almost like, you know, don't post up too many photos for people to see you back in New Zealand, because by the time you go back there, you might have got all fat again. That was my mindset.
Self-sabotage?
Oh, immensely. Mm. And you, that's one thing on my, I now have a page that I've dedicated to my journey, but that was my big block of stopping my page, because once I started my page, I knew I had to continue this lifestyle. I couldn't give up. And I didn't want to give up, but I didn't want to have all that weight on me of not being able to give up. I kind of wanted, if I wanted to eat a chocolate bar, I wanted to eat it, and I didn't want to have to justify it. And then I was like, well, hang on, all these pages, I follow all these pages of all these women that, you know, eat healthy, never slip up. Reality is, we slip up.
We're human.
You know, I know, like most other women, when we, our monthly frenemy comes along, if I don't eat something that's really rich and creamy and sugary, I'm going to chew a limb off my husband, you know. If he stands in front of that pantry, I will remove him with my teeth.
And is that, by making it public, by creating that page, it's almost taking the choice away to go back into the old patterns? It's like, if I'm stepping forward, creating this page, I can stick with this. So it was making another commitment to yourself that, yeah, I'll continue. I'm not going to be 100% perfect, like you're saying, because none of us are. We just, and like you say, there's a false portrayal put out there that you have to be 100% perfect. But, you know, we need to treat ourselves also. So that was your decision to make it public. Yes, if I continue with this,
yeah,
was another inspiration for you.
It was real, but it was stripped back, Casey. You know, I was stripping myself back, and I was putting myself out there, flaws and all. I'm not where I want to be just yet, and I let everybody know that. You know, I will post pictures of the parts of my body I'm not happy with, and you know, I will post triumphs, and I will post days where I'm feeling really low, and I just want to eat something because I want to. And I will, instead of saying, oh no, I've eaten a Turkish delight because that's my big vice, I love Turkish delights, I won't go, oh no, I've eaten a Turkish delight, oh no, what was me, what am I going to do? I will put on my page, I've had a bit of a crappy day, I've eaten half a Turkish delight, and you know what, I'm okay with that. You know, so saying to people that follow me, you know, don't, if you want to go ahead and eat a Turkish delight, don't sit in the corner swaying for the rest of the afternoon going, oh my god, I ate a Turkish delight. You know, it happens, and it's okay.
And what are the responses like from your page when you put something like that? What do your followers say?
A lot of them are like, me too. Or, you know, I eat coconut ruffs. Or my thing is, you know, and they start coming out, and it's like, don't hide from something that's real. You know, slipping up is real. If we were all mechanically minded and everything was all, what a boring world that would be. You know?
And it's the sharing. So if you're sharing and being honest, then they can say, actually, they can get real and honest with themselves too, because you're showing them the way.
Yeah. And some of them use, you know, they'll be like, oh, my kids did this, so I, you know, ate this, or my children played up today and I couldn't handle it anymore and I hid in the wardrobe and I ate a chocolate bar.
So they can identify triggers and openly speak about them.
Yeah. And I love that and I encourage that.
Now, you said something interesting. Well, everything's been interesting, but a little earlier about how your husband could love you. He must have rocks in his head. And like the thought of someone can't love us, and definitely not like that, if we don't look a certain way. Where do you think like that correlation sort of split?
I don't know. At the time, you know, when Casey was 159 kilos, I didn't think, oh, why do you love me? Because it's really weird, because the Casey me, I'm speaking of myself in the third person, because I do believe I'm not the person I used to be, not only to look at, but internally, I was very self-destructive. You know, I'm surprised my husband actually even stuck around as long as he had. I had a green-eyed monster that reared its head, and it wasn't because I obviously subconsciously was not happy with how I looked, but I wasn't going to let anybody else know that. You know, I would cry about my size, but I wasn't going to let anybody else see me do that. And I was in self-destruct mode, and I didn't know I was doing it until I now will think back on times of then and go, whoa, what was I doing? I should have appreciated the moment we were in, and the times that I had with these certain people and my husband and certain events in my life, instead of trying to ruin them because of how I felt, but I didn't want to bring out how I felt. Does that make sense?
It absolutely does. And that's, so that was that the almost like the green-eyed monster was protecting you from something?
Mm.
And so it was attack before being attacked, or...
And I did.
Yeah.
I did. And I'm a massive emotionally bearing person. I take on everybody's woes. For some reason, I'm like this absorbing being when somebody has something bad happened in their life. It's, hey, I know, well, I'll just go and offload it all to Casey. She's all good with that because she shows no emotion. And I was very emotionless. But on the inside, it was like every time someone threw a problem at me, there was another kilo and another kilo. And we're just going to throw all these kilos at you and ta-da! You're like 160 kilos and there's nothing you can do about it.
Until the day you did.
Yeah.
And as part of that then, because you were conscious that when people were offloading onto you, you were then going to eat it.
Yeah.
Their emotions to deal with it.
I was.
Did you then move away from certain people because you realised that, or say, well, actually, I can't hear this anymore from you because it affects me? Did you make any shifts like that?
I never directly said it, and to this day I still won't, because I love knowing that, you know, if someone's in a really bad time of need, that they can come to me for anything. Of my friends, I'm never going to turn any of them away. I now deal with it a little bit. Instead of eating it, I run it. And this sounds really horrible, but when I run, there's a certain track I do these days, and it has a bit of a downward slope. You do probably about a third of the course, and there's a downward slope. And that downward slope's a little bit enclosed, so it's not on the road, and it's in a bit of a reserved area, so no one can see me. And when I am running that bit, I scream. I clench my fists, and anything that I've got going on in me, I just run as fast as I can. And it's almost like some days I'll cry. That's how wound up I'll be because of it. I'll cry my way through it. Or I'll get to the end of that little, and I'll just start laughing, and I'll run the next little flat bit, and I'm just cracking up at myself. If people actually do see me, I think they will be very scared and think, what is wrong with that lady?
Should we let some mental hospital know she's loose?
But some therapies will actually, you know, it's getting it out of your body. It's getting out of your system so that it's out. And then, you know, rather than shoving it down and eating it, or, you know, we use many different ways of coping with it, you're actually saying, well, you're not healthy. out you go.
So it's got to go somewhere. Everything you put in, you know, has to come out. And whether it's food that obviously comes in and comes out, or it's an emotion, you've got to let it in and let it out. That's why we cry. That's why we laugh. That's why we frown. That's, you know, and that's my little, I'm not going to turn you away. If you're upset, please talk to me because I love you. But I'm going to let it out in the craziest way possible.
Well, they say that tears are the words we cannot say.
Yeah.
So it's all part of that. Sometimes, do you think we can get so caught up in words and being verbal that we forget the power of other ways of doing it? Like you say, through running, through shouting, through crying, you can. It's actually very powerful.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, really much. Yeah, no, completely.
I mean, it's better to do it there than on someone else. You know, letting out, if we're upset or angry, taking it out on someone else, you're doing it in a very safe space.
Yeah.
Going, okay, this is just to whoever, wherever.
Yeah.
I'm not harming or hurting anyone.
Yeah. And snakes aren't going to bite me because they're all going.
We don't want to go around there. No.
Yeah. She might bite us back. We're going.
Now, as part of the running, did you go on a particular or follow a particular diet or way of eating?
Eating came after, so the running sort of came first, and then the eating came. Now, I come from a family where, you know, mashed potato was with every meal, and gravy, and you could pretty much put your plate back in the cupboard when you're finished because you sop up everything left on it with bread. That's my bringing up. And I kind of chopped things out along the way. Like, I loved pasta, cheese, fizzy. I didn't really have a very good diet, you know, so I can't look at my weight and go, but I ate so well when I was so big. Yeah, bum bum, what a liar. I ate poorly. I lied to my husband. He would send me to go and get KFC, and I would have him a Zinger burger. I would have me a Zinger burger. He would be at home, but I would also get a snack burger, and I would eat that before I got home, so that when we got home, he would see I made 3/4 of my Zinger burger and be full. And in my brain, he'd be thinking, oh, good girl, you haven't, you know, you can't finish your burger. I'll finish it for you. You know, you only ate 3/4 of it. Little did he know, on the way home, bringing it home, I've actually downed a small chips and a snack burger.
Yeah.
And disposed of the evidence.
Yeah. It's lying to your husband. Was it also lying to yourself in the way?
Yeah. Because I would spend the whole time, every mouthful going into, I would be justifying that mouthful, you know, and it made absolutely no sense. You know, I would use stupid excuses like, well, I've got polycystic ovaries, so I'm going to be fat anyway, I might as well just eat, you know. I don't have polycystic ovaries anymore.
Uh-huh.
I had endometriosis, I don't have that anymore.
And what do you attribute to not having those conditions anymore to?
I had a doctor, you'll find this funny, I had a doctor say to me when I'd realised I was borderline 160 kilos and I was like, oh my God, I'm going to die. I had a doctor say to me, Casey, your weight's not your fault, but it's now your problem. And I was like, kind of is my fault. I eat a lot of stuff I probably shouldn't eat. And he was like, no, you've got. So he justified it to me. He justified to me why I was fat. And he was a doctor. So he was like, but you've got polycystic ovaries and, you know, endometriosis. It's just, that's part and parcel of. So I walked out of there going, well, how's that? I can eat anything I want. I've got polycystic ovaries.
Ticket.
Just whoop, get it in ya. You know? And honestly, if I could slap that doctor upside the head right now, I probably would, you know.
So did you do that then? Did you go out and just say, well, it's okay now and eat? Or did you stop yourself?
No.
Okay, I did. So that gave you free license
that
to gave
me, that was that was that was my whole pass to eating. It was like, I've got polycystic, you know, and people would say to me, Casey, look how much you're eating. And I'd be like, I've got polycystic ovaries. Deal with it. You know, there's just this attitude that the doctor went pretty, I feel like my doctor handed me my attitude and went, here you go. You can just eat for the rest of your life. Because at the same time, he also said to me, you've got awesome, perfect blood pressure, perfect cholesterol. And I was like, I'm sweet then. Good.
So you could justify everything that you were doing.
In here.
Yeah. Yeah. Right, in your mind.
In
yeah.
my mind. And oh, if I could go back and see Casey 4 years ago. Oh, I would shake for stupid. I really would.
But she didn't know any better at the time, did she?
No.
So what? When did you decide, okay, yes, I may have polycystic ovaries, however, I can do make some changes?
Even throughout the first bouts of my running, I was the whole, you know, I saw the weight coming off, but it was like, yeah, but I've got polycystic ovaries, you know. It was always there. It was always, and then I would feel the pain and everything like that. And because back in, sorry, I'm jumping all over the place, but back in New Zealand, I was told, because I had two cysts within 6 months, that had burst into my uterus space. And the second one that happened, the doctor said to me, look, Casey, this is going to keep happening. You know, we would look down the avenue of doing like a full hysterectomy. And I was like, no, we want another baby. And this is pre my son. We want another baby. And they were like, if you have another bleed within the next 6 months, because, you know, your weight and you can't sort of handle it and stuff like that, we will give you a hysterectomy. So left there, 3 months later, we're pregnant with my son. Because they also said to me, look, because of the size you are and with your polycystic ovaries, your chances of conceiving are slim. Clearly my husband made that happen.
What do you think? Why do you think you did fall pregnant there? Because sometimes women who have sought out fertility treatment for years stop the fertility treatments and 3 months later are pregnant. So do you think there's a mindset around it as well? Or it is a physical?
This sounds really weird, but I think that every single step in my life up until sitting with you here today is just sitting up there somewhere, and it's all predestined for me. And everything that I've done is meant to have happened, and it's meant to have happened how it's happened. I don't think I was meant to be born slim and perfect and, you know, have a great life. And I've had so many things happen. You know, I lost my mum when I was 9 years old. She was killed in a car accident. And, you know, everything is just, it's almost like my life got all the crappy stuff out of the way before I turned 35, so that after I turned 35, it's just going to be all smooth sailing.
So you've learned from all of that, and what happened?
Cross fingers.
As a child, had you been overweight?
Yep. My aunties and that tell me my mum had me on diets when I was little. I don't remember, but my mum had me watching what I was eating because I would just eat anything that was inside, and I was very much a look at me child. A bit of a show pony.
You never would have guessed it, eh?
I love the red hair.
Look at me.
I'm a home and vegan.
But you have an amazing, bouncy, bright, bubbly personality. So that has helped you get this far too in your journey and losing the weight.
Yeah. And it has, because even some of my closest friends from back in the day look at photos of me now and they're like, we never realised you were as big as you were, because I was as big this way as I was this, you know. So yes. It was, and they look at pictures and they're like, whoa, you were massive, you know. And I'm like, yeah, a little bit. You're only just realising that now. The fact that I could never wear your clothes as much as I wanted to.
And that goes back to, you know, what your husband was saying. They saw you.
Yeah.
They didn't see, you know, this and make judgments on it. They just saw you.
Yeah.
Which is beautiful.
And I'm glad that part of me hasn't changed. So many other aspects of me have. I am, believe it or not, more confident than I used to be, and I was pretty confident. But I've learned to deal with things as they happen as well and not bottle things up.
Yeah.
Like part of my weight loss journey as well, I dealt with losing my mum. And that's a massive space to not deal with something and then, you know, 25 years later deal with it whilst you're losing weight. And it was almost like every kilo I lost a problem that I had just let. It was like I was a barnacle. You know, and everything just attached to me, and every kilo I just that's gone, you know. And I dealt with everything one at a time, and man, my husband's seen me go through some moods, some dark stuff that I suppressed for a really long time, and that's okay. That is so okay now because I've dealt with it and I've rebuilt bridges that I mended because I blocked everybody out because I didn't want to know that you were worried about my weight because you were just deluded. I'm fine. You know,
yeah.
I've re-mended bridges and I've got a new appreciation for what life can offer. You know, there's watch out, world, there's more Casey to come, you know. That's how I am right now. I dressing like this and it not being, I mean, being here with you is a special occasion, but I wear this to the shopping centre, you know, and I'm not wearing leggings and Ugg boots and big triple XL jumpers. I'm doing this and this is great. I love it.
And is that because there's a part of you being expressed now that wasn't being expressed before? Because you've got the beautiful blouse on, you've got your heels on, and so you're feeling quite, what do you say, alluring or...
I feel beautiful.
Beautiful, yeah.
You know, I feel... I don't... Like, back then I would be like, yeah, I've got a pretty face. Because so many people would say to me, oh, but you've got such a lovely personality and beautiful eyes. Don't worry about your weight, you know. And
how so, do you feel when people say that?
Well, I didn't take it like the way I probably should have. I should have taken it like, so my weight probably is a problem. I should do something better. I took it the same way as the doctor with the polycystic ovaries. I took it, I've got pretty eyes and a great personality, you know. And that I... I get angry when I think about how I dealt with it because I swear I was dropped on my head as a child. but something just, the obvious that was looking at me down a barrel, like I didn't click to it, you know? And now I, and even then I would dress myself up the best I could. You know, I bought a photo of to show you of my wedding day, and I seriously on that day thought I looked so beautiful. Now, it was my wedding anniversary 2 weeks ago. My daughter and I, she's now almost 11, we were both inside my wedding dress for my photo, my recent photo of my wedding dress that I took up the whole thing on my own and, you know, blobbled out of corners and parts of it. Now my daughter fits in it with me and there's still room for more.
Right, well, let's have a look at the photo.
That is the best of my wedding photo.
The camera there.
So it's 7 years ago.
Okay, so you were married 7 years ago.
Yeah.
And you felt beautiful on that day.
I felt, the look on my face now, I'm like, why did you feel beautiful? You look like a misery guts. I mean, to be the happiest day of your life, you know. I married the man of my dreams.
But isn't it the most important thing on that day was how you felt? Which is on that day you felt beautiful.
Yeah. And these days I feel more beautiful than that when I get out of bed and I look all disheveled. Yes. And I still feel better than that.
Do you think that is also to do with how you feel inside, not just externally? Like feeling beautiful on the inside is, like, for me, is more important than on the outside.
Mm-hmm.
So for you, when you wake up in the morning, you're feeling beautiful on the inside and outside?
Yeah.
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 So it's like the two come together.
They do. They do. And I don't... Yeah. I've got... as my weight's lost, though, I have kind of got a bit... I can't even think of the word I'm trying to think of. Back when people used to, you know, oh, tell me their problems and things like that, I'd be like, oh, now I'm very toughen up, man. You know, people say, oh, I can't do this. Oh, I can't do that. And I'm like, you serious? I ran around an oval. Like, you couldn't even see my knees past my stomach and breasts. And I ran around an oval. Don't tell me you can't do that. You know, so I'm a bit, I've got a bit ballsy as the weight's come off. And I've got a bit, some would say snarky sometimes. I don't suffer falls as much as I used to.
Yeah, because you've walked it, you've done it, and you know what's possible.
Yeah.
And what if, because obviously to go through that, you have to dig inside and find some things to hold on to and develop some tools and strengths within yourself. What do you know what they are? Are you aware of them yet? What it was?
I think there's like a fire in my belly. I want to give the world the Casey that it's supposed to have.
Yes.
And that sounds so wrong. But I want to be more than just someone you pass in the shops. You know, I'm awesome and I feel awesome and I know I'm awesome and I look in my husband's eyes and he thinks I'm awesome and I look at my children and they think I'm awesome and eventually I've started to believe I'm awesome and I need to get that awesome out there. So there's more case, you know, I'm not at my goal. I've still got 13 more kilos to lose.
Okay. Where do you want to be?
To where I want to be. So yep. I want to be 80 kilos.
Yep.
And then I'm going to deal with my loose skin issues because naturally being as big as I was, there is loose skin and you can't run that stuff off.
Yes. You know, it's so interesting and I think it's brilliant that you've embraced your awesomeness. I think you're awesome. And I think you're awesome for being here today. And
thank you.
Your story will inspire.
Thank you.
Our viewers. It's in society, are we allowed to say I'm awesome without thinking my ego is too big? Or, you know, are we encouraged to think great things about ourselves?
We're not, but who cares?
Because you're owning it. You're owning your awesomeness and who you are.
Thank you.
Really taking your space in the world and wanting to help and inspire, which is absolutely brilliant.
Well, I just feel like I wasted space for so many years. I wasted this awesome oxygen that I was given, you know.
You were doing the degree course for 35 years, yeah. That's all.
Yeah. And I'm, you know, I'm graduating module by module, kilo by kilo. And there's just that women aren't made to feel like it's okay. You know, like you'll see someone walking through the shops and they've got their head up high and they're strutting their stuff. And, you know, so many people will be like, who does she think she is? Whereas if I actually heard someone say that in the shops, I'd be like, oh, I'm Casey Gimmel. How are you? You know?
Brilliant.
And I would say that now. Whereas beforehand, I'd be like, oh. Slunch the back, back up, you know, back over and just try and sort of be in the background. But,
disappear.
But I've always had this awesome personality, but I felt like it just got chipped away, chipped away, chipped away, chipped away. And now I'm getting it back and I'm claiming it back because it's mine and I want to own it. And I don't care if you have a problem with it. If now my outlook on life with people is if you have a problem with me, go away. I'm not going to change. I spent too many years of my life changing myself to fit in with you. If you want to fit in with me, fantastic. I'm not changing a single thing about me because I've finally got to a place where I really, really love me.
Wow. And acceptance.
And I nearly cried doing that.
Same, it made me want to cry.
Oh, it's beautiful. And I am so grateful that you're saying this because I think so many women that we're watching that need to hear that, that really need to hear that too, so that they can be their own awesomeness. Because everybody's awesome, we just hide it.
Yeah.
It's like that Lego song, everything is awesome.
Everything is cool when you're part of a team.
And it's true.
Be in my team. Come and be in my team.
So what would you say to viewers watching today if they're about to start losing weight, thinking about it halfway through, or they're having a really big chocolate day? What would you say?
Eat that chocolate. Enjoy that chocolate. Know that you're going to work that chocolate off. You might not do it today. You might not do it tomorrow. Set yourself little goals. The worst thing someone can do is go, I'm 160 kilos and I want to be 70 kilos. That is so far away, you know. Set yourself little goals. So set yourself, you know, I want to be 150. I want to be in the 40s. I want to be in the 30s. And when you reach every step, reward yourself. Don't reward yourself with food. Food can be a reward. You know, by all means, go get a Baskin Robbins at this weight. But reward yourself with, it could be something as little as a bright coloured lipstick. I'd never, ever worn bright lipstick before losing my weight. I was all neutral tones. Everything was neutral. I blush it up now and red lipstick and I'm, you know, little goals and reward yourself. Buy yourself a bunch of flowers. You know, if it makes you feel nice walking past and having that smell, and it's that smell is a reminder, oh, I reached my goal this week. Awesome. It may not be big to someone else. If it's big to you, do it. Do whatever makes you happy and know that you're gonna fall over. And it's okay. It's how you pick yourself back up.
That's what counts, getting back up. Fall down 7 times, get back up 8.
Yeah, you might take 3 steps forward, 2 steps back. I sound a bit like Paula Abdul.
We're doing a lot of songs.
I know, it's awesome. I love music. You know, and music is awesome. Trigger songs. You know, I've got trigger songs that I started running to almost 3 years ago. I still run to those trigger songs because they're, you know, one of them's Darude, Sandstorm, you know, and it's, as the music gets faster, I get faster and faster and faster and faster and you know, have those triggers, have things that make you appreciate your little steps you're making, you know.
And it sounds like also you're making friends with yourself. Like, first of all, it's being seen. Well, I'm going to wear bright lipstick and then I'm going to give myself flowers, because we have this expectation that we can't do those things for ourselves or someone else has to do them for us or we're not worth it. Whereas you're saying as part of the process and the reward, it's like getting to know yourself and what do I like? Like, someone might like flowers, or you like lipstick. Someone else might like going to a movie or the theatre. It could be anything, couldn't it?
It could be. And just don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to fail. I think a lot of people have a mindset that they write themselves off before they begin. Don't be afraid to fail. I failed more times than I've succeeded. But it's my success that's lasted. You know, it's oh, I don't even know the words. It's you know, it's like the Adam Sandler movies. You can do it!
Yes, always that dude in those movies.
You can do it! You can do it. Don't let anybody tell you you can't do it, because the only person that can stop you from doing something is you. And if you're going to stop yourself and you're going to keep voiding yourself, that's just going to become a routine. You need to make that decision to break a routine, to break a habit. And just roll with it.
So you're building
up
a mindset.
Don't expect too much of yourself. You know, I didn't expect that. Like I said at the beginning, I did not expect I could run 5Ks. You know, if I'd have done those whole 8 weeks going, ooh, 5Ks again, you know, don't expect anything. Let what happens gonna happen. You should have seen me the first time I actually made it once around that oval consistently. Everybody that was there with their dog and children knew that that was the first time I'd made a complete circle of that oval, because I was like, wow, you know. And some people were like, I run that thing 10 times, what's that lady on about? And it's like, dude, I don't care, I just ran it once and that was amazing.
So appreciate what you do instead of beating yourself for what you don't. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show today. You've been awesome, and you are a true inspiration, and I really look forward to seeing where you go next.
Thank you for having me.
So thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. If you'd like to hear more about Casey's story or go into our chat room and have a chat and share information, you can go to our website, www.1000women1000ways, and we look forward to chatting with you there, and we'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.